Hello. Hi there. How we doing? It warms my heart to see this many people in this room this afternoon. Rugs, who knew, right? How many people own one of these rugs? Wow.
Wow, that's good.
That's very good.
That's very good.
Thank you so much. Just a little bit of housekeeping. The restrooms are located on the lower level. And this program is being live streamed. And as a special thank you to our live stream sponsor, WGLT, Bloomington Normal's Public Media, part of the NPR network. I'm excited about this one, so let's get right to it. Good friend of mine, Hossein.
Thank you.
Hossein Nateghpour is the owner of Pars World Gallery. He started his business in 1987. As part of the former Weaver's Furniture Company on Oakland Avenue. Hossein would like to see a day when every house has at least one fine rug, and look like most of you are already there. And he comes from a family with a rug making background and grew up with a deep appreciation for the ancient art form. He loves educating customers about rugs and the art and cultural expression of rug making. So help me give a warm welcome to our friend Hossein.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Jeff, for the warm introduction. I appreciate that. And I guess I don't have to talk so much about myself now. And I have been in Bloomington since 87, dealing with carpets from restoration, cleaning, to selling to some of you and other people. I definitely appreciate the art, and I think it's a bit sadness feeling that I have that because of a whole lot of situations in the country of Iran, the art, it's sort of disappearing, and that's because of due to the labor and also mismanagement in many ways. So we don't talk about that. Today we're going to talk about rugs. That's me again with Martha Stewart. I had an opportunity to get introduced to her and sign a contract and sell some of her design that is created in rugs. She's into everything from painting, you all know, and she already has a hands-on some rug designs. And some of it are very pretty, a lot of it modern, which, you know, feeds the market today. So not so much talking about me myself. Yes, I did started in a V-Birch Furniture, the beautiful owner, Mr. Jim Mitchell, God bless him. He passed away some years ago. Some of you might have even bought furniture from him. He was on Oakland Avenue, and I started my business over there. I was into a wholesale at that time, so I had rented a space and put some rugs and was selling and traveling back then to countries from China to India and Pakistan. At that time, you know, I was just going over there for purchase and bringing rugs, do part of it as a wholesale, and then some of it at retail, at V-Birch Furniture. And a little bit later, I started auctioning almost every January after Christmas. Joy Luke Auction Galleries, some of you might have been there or familiar with it. I auctioned off over one night a lot of rugs. I missed that because there was a lot of people from community would come and enjoy that type of a sale. It was the end of the year. I had to clear some merchandise and get my cash to be able to have purchase newer rugs. Anyways, talking about carpet, how rugs are started. Well, it dates back to to Persia. Rugs, some people believe that, you know, it was a means of protecting yourself from the nature, because, you know, they used wool and it was warm and they sat on it as a furniture. And some people think it started with decoration. So they started decorating and making weaves instead of sheepskins and everything else that they used. Now they use decorative ways to make rugs. So the origin obviously comes from what's left Iran today. Iran, Persia was a big empire, so it goes, you know, to some part of Ottoman Empire, Turkish, and Kazakhstan. Now all of those areas have the art, and as well as India, and also China. Now, we're talking about how rugs are woven. It is a vast, in some ways, and complex work. It is an art that you have to learn how to weave. I make an example sometimes. It's like playing piano. You just can't be a pianist one day. You just have to start by clapping, by doing, you know, the notes and learning. The same way is rug making. So they usually, in old times, they started with young ages. A lot of them girls, ladies, because they had tinier hands and they had more time around the house to be able to do that. The man maybe was farming and doing other type of work. But man and woman both are involved. The best material for the carpet, in my opinion, is wool. Although silk is used because it's shinier, fancier, and also stronger. There's a saying that silk is stronger than steel in physics. So it is a strong material, but it gets dirty faster, and it has a different feeling. So when you touch a silk, it's always cold. When you feel a wool rug, it's more warmer, it keeps the temperature. So wool, where does it come from? Sheep, you know, many types, usually. The sheep has to be, you know, sheared. The wool has to be carded and scorn, and the wool has to be spun. And then after that, it has to get washed. Then goes to a dyeing process. There's the little sheep, there's scorning and spinning and dyeing. That dye is the indigo, which is the best dye you could ever have. It's preservative to the wool in such a way that when you look at antique rugs, the area that is used with an indigo, the pile still so much there, and some of the colors that were maybe more acidic to the wool, it has worn. So then we go to the design. Design has to be created. A weaver has to read the design and weave. Now, in some areas, there are some rugs, like a gabbe later on, like maybe I can lift it up. This is a nomadic gabbe design. Now, this particular one was designed by a group of people, maybe in workshops. The more of these in the past, they were coarser, and the name gabbe means, in Farsi, coarse. So this was used with nomadic people. Now, nomadic people didn't have that design so much. They created the rugs from the nature. Whatever their surrounding was, mainly a lot of colors, maybe some leaves and some goats or a rooster or a rabbit or whatever, you know, they had in their imagination to put on it. But I do have a loom over here. Later on, you guys can come closer and look at it. So this is the cartoon figure. that has to be designed. So a designer is a separate person, never a weaver, hardly. So all of this, every color, this rug over there has only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, maybe 9 colors in there. And that's for experiment, just showing how the rug weaving is. Usually Persian rugs have more than 30, 20 colors, or some of them even 50 or 60 colors involved, different shades. So usually not the whole rug gets designed or printed. This is a quarter of it, usually border, and a quarter of it, since it's symmetric, they turn it around and use this to make the other part of it. So at least a quarter of the rug has to be designed in paper. I'll try to, and that's the weaver that later on sits in front of a loom and start weaving the carpet. After the carpet is done, there's still process, the process of shearing. Sometimes shearing happens while the rug is woven. I have some tools. I brought these from Iran. This is a scissor that it sets on a pile, as you can just use this and cut. So everything hand woven. And this is the knife that separates the warps, so you can put the knotting in to, and also cut the yarn with the knife. And this is the comb, which after the rug is woven, the pile is woven, the weft is made, then it's getting packed into place. Also have...
I apologize, I dropped the microphone. Thank you very much. I apologize. And this is a rug beater. I found this at Gridley Antique Shop. So anyways, let's go forward with the slides. Now, this is a picture of the oldest rug that we have. It goes back to about 300 years before the birth of Christ. So this is the oldest in existence. It's called Pazayak, and it is right now in a Hermitage Museum in St. Petersburg. The gentleman, the archaeologist named Sergei Rudenko, in 1949, I believe, when they were digging the graves and the tombs in Alti Mountain in North Siberia, which is close to above Kazakhstan and maybe close to China and Mongolia, they found the tomb and they found this rug. The rug is intact, and it's surprising. They still today study how this rug, even in ice, just survived. A lot of people thinking it's because of the type of the colors, the fermentation that they used to use to make the dyes, that it protected the wool in such that all the colors are there. And this goes back to the Achaemenid Empire in Iran. So when the rug was found, they found out that this was maybe 100 years older than the king or the person that it was mummified. So they think that this maybe was a gift to from Persia to somebody important. The rug is absolutely beautiful. Later I have a
a video of it that I can maybe go through the pictures and then start showing some of the videos, and you will see the museum and you will see this rug. So we've talked about dyeing process. Wool, when it's carded, it's dirty after scorning, and then fermentation is the best way of cleaning. Wool has a lot of lanolin oil from sheep fleeces. Some of that has to come out because it may stink, it may have odors. So all of that with fermentation will, part of it will come out, and they use that for a lot of maybe medicine, lip balms and other things, you know, all that lanolin used for cream and other purposes as well. So dyeing process, the best dyes available to humankind, I think it's natural. Those dyes are just amazing. And when it's done correctly, the rug would look good. Even the colors would look after 100 years. I do have some rugs over here. A lot of these are vegetable dyes, not all of them, particularly this rug. This rug is Caucasian, and it goes back to about 1870. It's one of my oldest rug in my collection. I've had it for probably 20 years. I have it in the store, and I never wanted a part from it because it's part of my collection. So it's not for sale. And so then chrome-based dyes and other things, you know, you have, when you dye, you have to have some kind of molten to make the dyes. Dyes have to absorb to the wool with some kind of a salt, aluminum, or other molten that you use. But fermentation, again, is the best way. The only dye, in some ways, that doesn't need any more than salt or anything, that's the indigo. That goes through fermentation. That is absolutely one of the best dyes. So we're talking about how the rugs are made. So foundation of the carpet is figured out over here. It consists of warps that goes up and down. Maybe if I don't drop my microphone, I'll come over here. These are warp. This alone technique to make this with the separation of a front and a back to be able to weave, sometimes even weavers don't even know how to do this because they'll make a mistake. So there's always every notch in the field, somebody knows how to create this. So they bring that guy or a gentleman or a girl to do this stretching of the yarn or cotton material, basically, a lot of times, or silk, and then weave on it. So there, every knot is considered of a loop. So it's not a tied knot, it's a loop. There's two types of knotting in Persian. There is Persian and Turkish, which call azari. And that's just a different formation of how one is symmetric and one is asymmetric. And later on, I will show you in picture. So once the knotting is done, there's a thread that goes across and calls weft. And there's a tool for that. And I do have videos to show you. So this is, they call this shooter. So they hook a weft and pull it across. And then they pack it with an iron comb. So now, they're rugs that only have single weft, okay? And then there are rugs which has maybe 3 to 4 weft. The more of the weft that goes on the carpet, the stronger the pile is, and it'll hold up together. Like a rug, you might have heard, Bijar from Iran is a Kurdish area that they make the tightest, the finest carpets, I believe, from Iran, and they call it the iron rug of Iran. And that is used about 4 weft across. So one just knotting and 4 weft, it takes time. So usually nowadays, the rugs that made today, a lot of it made in India, some even don't even have a weft. So you could, it's just a matter of time and production. You can just pull it and it may just come apart. And this is that cartoon figure. So it has to be designed. And these are the tools that I have shown you, from the shooter to the scissor to the knife and to the comb. Now, this is Persian. These are two major type of handmade rugs knots. So one is asymmetric. So the loop, you can see how it is in illustration. And the Turkish or Azeri, which is part in Iran, that's how they knot it, they come symmetric from the middle. So they pull it that way and bring it down. There's really no difference which one is better than the other. I think both are as good. Now I have some pictures of rugs. Rugs in Iran has regions. So when you hear, rugs names, so when I call like a Suruk, Suruk is a town in Iran. So every rug name goes back to a region, from Afshar to Ahar to Angeles to Aran, Ardabil, Ardakan, Asarabad. These are like Bloomington, Normal, Chicago, San Francisco, all of these areas. And usually they don't take somebody else's region design and work on it. This has been in the smaller sort of communities, and they were proud of what they were making, and they were just doing that for that region. Bakhtiari, this is some of the most beautiful, in my opinion, designs. They call it panel. So every panel has an element of a design to it, and that's a Bakhtiari, a Kurdish part of Iran. This is a gabbe, like the one that I have on the floor over here, and these are more nomadic, folk art type of rug weaving. Kashan, one of the best towns in Iran, they actually claim that textile started in that part of the world. They have museums in Kashan, it's a beautiful city, and it's one of the oldest city in Iran. I wish one day we can all live peacefully and travel over there together. There is a whole lot of beauty of Iran that the world needs to see. This is Suruk. Suruk was created around 1920s. So in a lot of books, Americans wrote it. Some called it American because it was made for US market. They all came to New York it was the Victorian era of housing and design, so Americans loved it so much. A lot of them came to US, and because of the long travel back and forth, the dyes were organic, so the rich burgundy that the Victorian time people in America wanted it wasn't there. So a lot of these by a lot of Iranian Jewish families that they were in New York, that they handled the rug business, the Assyrians, Armenians, and also the Jewish family, that they still exist. And so the heart of business actually is still New York. There's a lot of old families I deal with. There are my Jewish friends. They painted this. It's very difficult once the rug is woven to go ahead and change the color. So you have to wet it for one thing because the colors will be patchy. I do have a Suruk on the floor, an American Suruk, one of the small ones, right there, that first one. So I have bigger ones in the store, but I brought in a smaller one to show you. And then Tabriz. Tabriz is northwestern Iran, and that town. It was closer to Turkey, so it has a little bit more in a way of transit. Has a lot of elements of European look to it too, because it was closer to send drugs out. There is more floral designs to the Tabriz, although they have other designs as well. It is some of the nicest rugs. Shiraz rug, and then Nain. These are some of the famous designs. And now I'd like to, I know we don't have a whole lot of time, but I want to show some videos that I have picked up on my YouTube channel, and I would like to go through. Maybe you can just look at it, and some of it I may have to fast forward a little bit because I pulled too many. Yeah, that's a good one. We can start that from the start. Can we make that bigger? There, thank you. I think we can go to this goes in detail. I want to fast forward it to another clip. So if you go to the next. Okay, so maybe I can show you this and then maybe a couple more. Okay. So if you want to make that bigger, full screen.
Fine details. Traditionally, Persian rugs are made from sheep's wool, which is boiled, spun, and dyed by hand. These bright and elaborate yarns are dyed with natural colors from plants and insects. In many regions, such as Yazd, hundreds of weavers may work in the same factory at any given time. However, here in Fars province, where cargo weaving is recognized as part of the UNESCO Intangible Cultural Heritage List, the materials are distributed to small villages for tribal women to weave in their homes.
گفتم حرف خونه ممکنه در فراخور سایز خودش داره همون سایز داشته باشه مثلا طرف خانمی ممکنه خونه کوچیکی داشته باشه داره کوچیکتر داره و فرقی داره فرشهای فارس میکنه مخصوصا کار تو جبه دگرگون سخت میکنه بافتش برای بافتن به خیلی سختتر میشه چون که دار فرشهای فارس زمینیه فرشهای فارس به صورت افقیه.
I'm going to fast forward this to another video.
The process of weaving a Persian rug differs slightly with each variety, but generally speaking, a bed of foundation material called warp is installed into the frame called a loom. Starting at the bottom, weavers then feed wool in between the warp, tying knots called weft on each one. A highly detailed silk rug can have over 1,000 knots per square inch. However, most carpets are not valued based on knot count, but rather their materials, design, and overall size.
So that was something I didn't talk about, horizontal and vertical. That's a vertical, and horizontal is much difficult on your back. A lot of the looms are, but in some nomadic area, they use that. This is very interesting. I want you to see. Sometimes weavers sing, whatever hum, like when you use a piano, you hum to learn. So this is interesting. I'll show you just a few minutes. Workshops are usually in Iran or at homes. It's not like big factories. So there's maybe few people. She's a spinning. So they're singing and they're getting each other's nerves. I'm going to keep going to different videos because the length are too long.
Yeah, we definitely want to leave time for questions.
Okay. So in maybe a couple of minutes, I'll stop the videos.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I stopped the video. I had a couple more, but I want to leave it up to a discussion so I can maybe hopefully answer some questions, and maybe we can a little bit informally talk to each other. So.
Yes.
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 Why is cotton used for the warp?
Good question. Very good question.
Because that seems to not have as long a life as the wool.
Absolutely. The best question you could have. The reason is, well, the abundance of cotton material, for one thing. And also, on the loom, it'll stretch nicely. It gives a tension that the weaver needs to go back and forth without breaking. So that is one thing. Wool, it'll stretch. So a lot of the wool foundation carpets, which are done in nomadic, and it's the best thing that you can use, or silk. Silk is expensive, obviously. So wool, the rugs, it's hard to make it straight and even, and it's more flexible. So maybe that is...
Could silk be used as the warp? Because that would be... not have, that would still not have its memory. Cotton doesn't have a memory. Wool has a memory.
Absolutely.
But does silk have a memory?
Yes, and silk is a strong material. So a lot of the finer carpets, for example, I have a haricot. This is an old, this is from 1940s. And it's used all silk. Every part of it. Silk is an expensive material, but everything from the weft to the warp, it's silk. Yes, I think it's just a matter of abundance. Cotton is...
And cost.
And it's hidden inside, and normally, so that's what they use. You're absolutely correct. Once the rug, which the pile wool is water repellent, so that's good, but once the water is introduced and gets to the foundation of the carpet, that cotton usually deteriorates. It molds. A lot of times I have seen in my experience people who had plants and put it on top of the carpet, and it seeped little bit, you know, by little bit. The pile is there, but the foundation is broken and the rug comes apart. Thanks for asking such a good question. I appreciate it.
What are some of the sources of the dyes? What do they start with, in some cases, bugs, or how do they, iron, and is any of it sun fade? Are they not sun fading?
Well, I'm not the biggest expert on dyeing process. From as little as I know, dyes, vegetable dyes, are better. In my years of experience, vegetables, dyes just adhere to wool in a different ways that I have not seen them fading as much. But I have recently rugs that I have sold in the market that I honestly, I have bought it back from the people because this is a small community. I did not know. There were in 1980s, Iran was producing a lot of rugs in the city of Tabriz. Some workshops, because it was just getting so popular and it was a smaller, a lot of the Persians that they lived in America after the revolution, they would go back to Iran and visit, and they wanted to put it in their suitcase and bring it back. So a lot of the Tabriz were just very famous. And these rugs were some manufacturing, some workshops, they use bad dyes. That dyes faded. I have not seen an antique rug in my life that it's faded so much, but I've seen you know, some new rugs from 1980s from Iran, especially from the city of Tabriz, that fading happened. So I believe that dye is very important in how the dye process is done. Chrome-based dyes are cheaper. You know, manufacturing, you can just go and just buy the dye and just use it. Vegetable dyes anywhere from pomegranate to walnuts to saffron, which saffron is very expensive, very little, but turmeric is used more often. You asked about bugs, yes. There are only one area in Iran, Mashhad, which in 1920s, they brought in cochineal bugs from Africa in abundance and smashed them, and this produced a dye that it's absolutely gorgeous. It's more richer, and so if when I see those type of rugs from a distance, I know that that was cochineal bugs, and that's old time. They don't much use that type of a dyes anymore. A lot of the dyes today, especially in countries from India to Turkey to China, especially, though especially India and China, everything is based on not organic, almost 99%. It's just done, you know, with chrome-based dyes. Thank you. Yes?
On the care of them and appraisals, is this something your shop does?
We have
We have a 9x12 Chinese wool silk.
Yes.
And I don't know how often we should get it appraised and how often we should get it cleaned.
Well, that's one thing that I want to talk about. Rugs do appreciate. Do not depreciate in value. So I have dealt with a lot of insurance companies, State Farm in particular, for many years before they moved their claim from here to Texas. For maybe 25 years, every week, you know, I had to do a few appraisals for them. So, and I do it for people as well. I believe maybe 15, 20 years, depends. Everybody knows that, like, from I would say maybe 1980s to recently, our inflation has been sort of handled and we haven't had much increase in many prices. But nowadays, it definitely is a different story. In the last couple of years after the COVID, it's high from a grocery standpoint to anything, raw material. Maybe there's some gouging in some ways happening, but we, for raw material, for everything else, for the carpet, for the machine-made rugs, my costs are twice as much as 2 years ago. And so I would say maybe wait, maybe if you haven't done your appraisal in the last 15, 20 years, this is a good time to do it, because the inflation speaks for itself.
And how often should they be cleaned?
It depends to your usage. Now, a lot of, we have cleaning facilities and we clean carpets. So in a business sense, you should say maybe every other year, every year. But I would tell people that when you see your rug, it doesn't have that shine. And it loses the vibrancy. That's the time to clean it, because it's hard to notice. Gradually, wool gradually gets dirty and you get used to it. So it's not like, you know, it was clean and then a week later it got dirty and then, well, yeah, it's time to clean it. But I would say maybe in traffic area, maybe 4-5 years in a traffic area. And then again, it depends to your household. If there's two of you, it's different. If you have, you know, 4 or 5 kids running around, maybe that's another story. So, but definitely cleaning. I think visually, a lot of times fringe is cotton. So that gets dirty faster, and you can tell when it's getting black, it's a little bit late. You should have cleaned it before it gets to that, you know, condition.
I think we can take one more.
In answer to that question, you should have it cleaned when your cat has an accident. But then, so we did that. We had a silk carpet from China that we bought in China, and we brought it to you, and you knew immediately that it was none of the above. It was fake. How do you tell?
That the material is not the right material? Well, experience in some ways, I guess. A lot of the rugs come from Iran. I strongly tell people, if you're buying silk, you're buying it for a collection, because it's more expensive. Rugs from Iran never gets cheated, because it's in a small community, it's a heritage, it's in history. The government of Iran, even today, if you want to export something, they have agents that they would come and examine every rug, and it has to be marked and stamped. So the nature is that in Iran, those carpets, if they tell you it's silk, it is silk. But in countries in China, unfortunately, and India, because the labor is cheaper and material, and sometimes they use materials like mercerized cotton, rayon, and other type of, call it art silk.
Heading of fake silk would be rayon, say?
I would say so. Nowadays they use viscose, which I'm appalled. I think viscose, it's a crime. Viscose is wood pulps, it's paper, you do not use that, it doesn't have. But I don't want to name the company, but there's a big company, multi-million dollars, that sells a whole lot, and we sell it. And to designers, I personally tell my customers not to buy it, but some designers, I deal with, they want those designs because designers are made it, and it's made of viscose, and it looks shiny and everything, but even on the back of the carpet, read it, information from this company, it says, do not wash. Why would you want to buy a rug under your feet and not wash it? So, all right. I hope I answered your question correctly, and I'm sorry that if I gave you the not as good of a news that this wasn't a real silk, but rugs usually, and sometimes they use that term art silk, just to get it. It's basically rayon and mercerized cotton.
Silk. Carpet in China, be careful.
Be careful. Work with a reputable dealer. And a reputable dealer that they're not going to lie to you. They're going to give you the right information that they have. So if they have the good information, they pass it along. And sometimes when you're in a tourist, maybe going overseas, and you're not knowing, and that might happen, maybe due to the language, barrier sometimes, but not rugs from Iran, I can guarantee you that. This thing doesn't happen.
Okay, thank you so much. I think I'll take that.
Thank you. One more thing, I do have an envelope, and it's a Christmas card I send out to my clients. Some of you might have it. There's $50 in there. It is my appreciation to you, and you can spend it any way you want to, if you want to. So that's yours as our gift.
Good. Thanks again, Hossein. I know that last bit of information, we'll take that to the bank with us, because you just never know how to tell what's really real and what's not. Again, I want to thank you all for coming, and we'd like to invite you back next month, where we'll have Adriana Ponce, and she'll be talking about Venezuelan Christmas traditions for us. December 14th. So with that, I bid you a good day, and you're welcome to visit the museum, come up and see some of the rugs, and I'm sure Hossein will be here for a little bit longer. Thank you.
I'll stick around for a little bit if anybody has any.